And you guys here, please forget everything that I said, and I'm going to try to do it again. Welcome all, for some for the second time, for some for the first time, both live in the Gazi Husserbeg Library here in Sarajevo and, of course, in the interwebs, to the ninth session, Music, Popular Culture, and Society. I'm going to be the chair for this exclusively online session. My name is Timur. You, of course, can ask questions, although everything is online, in any of the languages of the conference, and we're going to try to relay them to the presenters. As you could already have seen, the first paper presentation of today is actually a pre-recorded video by Samuel Murray. All the information is already in the Book of Abstracts, so I'm going to save you the time for that. And the paper is called Morello and Mimesis, Genre Signifiers and Political Commentary. Now, should I now play the video? No, still not. The video is going to be played momentarily. Enjoy the presentation.
Hello, I'm Sam Murray, and I'm from Falmouth University in the UK. It's really great to be here virtually, although I do really wish I was there in person. The paper I'm giving today is a follow-on to one I gave at the Psychology and Music Conference in Belgrade just over a month ago, and is titled Morello and Mimesis, Genre Signifiers and Political Commentary. So, I'll start by defining our key term for this paper, that being mimesis. The Oxford English Dictionary tells us that mimesis means an imitation, specifically the representation or imitation of the real world in a work of art, literature, etc. So, today we're looking specifically at sound mimesis in music, the imitation of real world sounds in music. And the use of mimesis in music has been discussed by several authors across a wide range of areas and styles, with Levin, Doolittle and Nattier describing its varied use in entertainment contexts, religious ceremonies, and for practical applications such as making animal call sounds for hunting purposes. But given mimesis' significant contribution to much early music making, Levin questions why it's not a more prominent part of present-day musical languages. Well, in my earlier mentioned paper entitled Conjuring Sound, Mimesis and Guitar Virtuosity, I examined exactly that and argued that mimesis is actually very common amongst rock and pop guitarists, where it's used to demonstrate a command of one's instrument and as a display of virtuosity. In today's paper, I explain how Morello uses mimesis in a much more nuanced and deliberate manner in order to communicate important aspects of his band Rage Against the Machine's musical and political identity to the listener. So, Morello's use of mimesis or mimicry is well documented, and Guitar World magazine had this to say on the matter. Animal, vegetable, mineral, whatever. You name it, and the man, Morello, will take out his guitar and mimic it. But his use of this technique to deliberately convey genre signifiers and musical meaning is, in my opinion, underexplored. So, in response to this, today's paper covers two main topics. Firstly, we'll look at some earlier research on Morello's political standpoint and his own comments on this matter, before we examine how the sounds he uses act as very specific sonic signifiers of his political viewpoint, and we go about tracing the origins of these sonic signifiers. So, in Levin's chapter in the book Political Rock, he explains how, quote, in many ways the members of Rage Against the Machine are first and foremost activists. In this sense, their fame and popular success, having sold over 16 million records, can be understood as their medium for consciousness raising. Through music and actions, the band has been a conduit for disseminating messages of critical thought, protest and causes for justice. It's nearly impossible to separate Rage Against the Machine's music from their message. He goes on from this to state the importance of the band providing a counter-narrative to the mainstream messages disseminated by the media, telling us that a major goal of activism is to disseminate information in the form of counter-narrative. In effect, the forceful and embodied production of counter-narrative, what we might call militant poetics, is the raison d'etre of Rage Against the Machine. Many writers, including Tuttle in 2013, and even Morello himself, have commented on how his sound is inspired by that of hip-hop. And Morello's quote on the matter is this: "It was really in the beginnings of Rage Against the Machine where I self-identified as the DJ in the band and stopped looking at the guitar as this hallowed instrument on which there was only one way to get good. Instead, it became a piece of wood with six wires, a few electronics, a couple of knobs and a toggle switch that could be deconstructed." So, given that Morello and many others have commented on this drawing of inspiration from hip-hop and seeing himself as the band's DJ, I thought it would be interesting to kind of trace the origins of this and to find out where it comes from specifically and how his sound becomes so associated with the counter-narrative that Morello and Rage Against the Machine are so keen to put across. It's important to understand from the start that anything that Morello does is deliberate and considered. He understands the messages imbued in his music and the sonic references he's making for his audience to deconstruct. His quote here from the Los Angeles Times article, where he says, "Music and meaning are always on a collision course in our culture. Music has the unique property of speaking to the individual and community in the language of our earliest ancestors. The right combination of rhythm and rhyme, when it washes over a throng or transmits through an earbud, can feel like the truth and resonate deep in our reptilian brain in a way that can provide a spark for action." So, before we go any further, I'm going to play you three examples of Tom Morello's lead guitar sound. This sound's famous for relying on a Digitech whammy pedal. And the key thing to know about this pedal is that it allows its user to pitch shift up to 2 octaves in real time. And this gives an approximation of the portamento sound found on some synths where we get this pitch glissando. Let's just have a quick look at three examples where he uses this particular pedal along with his distorted guitar sound to create this approximation of a synth. Let's have a quick listen. This is the guitar solo from Killing in the Name Of by Rage Against the Machine. Another one, as I said, this is a very commonly used sound for Morello. This is his kind of go-to lead sound. This is from Fistful of Steel, again by Rage Against the Machine. And finally, this is from one of his later bands called Audioslave. Again, we hear that same portamento sound being used here melodically for the guitar solo. So, to some, these may just sound like an affected guitar sound, but it is much more than that. This relatively simple sound is an important signifier of political intent, through an alignment with a long history of protest music and counter-narrative. To those in the know, this is a coded sign of rebellion by association. But where does this sound and also its association come from? Well, the use of the sound in the way Morello uses it has its origins in a funk record from 1972 by the Ohio Players, and more specifically in its synth solo played on an ARP synth by Junie Morrison. The presence of a portamento feature means that the notes gliss into each other and create what some have described as being similar to a whistle or a whine. Let's have a listen to this. This isn't what Morello is directly referencing. You see, the song took on a second life when it was sampled by several different artists. Let's just have a look at just three uses of this sample, and we can start to see how it became associated, particularly with anti-establishment protest music that presented a counter-narrative to the mainstream. So NWA used it twice. Firstly, on Dope Man, let's hear a little clip of it here where it's been sampled. Also used on the Minister's Black track, Step Into My Office. Have a listen. And even when the rising sound is only heard momentarily, as in the jazz track A Nation Divided, it still closely ties the artist to a subgenre in this particular time period. So, since then, Dr. Dre, who incidentally was the producer for NWA, who popularised the sample within political hip-hop and rap, has kind of taken the sound as something of a trademark, and we now see him now not only use the sample, but also use a similar whistle synth sound, but played by musicians on many of his productions. For example, see Snoop Dogg, Dre's own records, and the work of many other West Coast G-Funk artists. Even if just present in a snippet, this sound has made its way onto many examples of protest songs, particularly in its earlier uses. It's perhaps since become a more mainstream sound and is arguably no longer necessarily associated primarily with protest music. However, at the time Tom Morello was referencing it, around the late 80s, early 90s, it was definitely a kind of sonic signifier of protest. So, to summarise, Tom Morello's use of effects which create a similar sawtooth wave sound and a rising and falling portamento effect a deliberate attempt to align himself with one of the key signifiers of G-funk rap and anti-establishment protest music. But Morello's lead sound is not the only way in which he aligns himself with hip-hop, and as previously mentioned, he describes himself as the DJ of the band. And here are a couple of examples of him playing the role of a DJ by imitating and emulating the scratches and cuts of a turntablist, by scraping the strings on his guitar while manipulating the pickup toggle switch to emulate the cutting between two records. Let's have a listen to it live. And also occupying the traditional place of a guitar solo in the kind of third verse, here is Bulls on Parade, where instead of a kind of expected guitar solo we might expect from a rock band, we get Morello scratch. Okay, this is not the only way in which Morello uses mimesis to signify political intent. He also mimics police sirens and helicopters to reinforce lyrics which deal with police corruption and brutality. So let's hear an example. The first sound you're going to hear is a recording of the rising kind of two-chirp siren of the LA police car. So let's have a listen to this. This is the actual sound of the police car. And this is Morello imitating that sound in the Rage Against the Machine song Bully in Your Head, which is about corrupt police officers. And finally, in another song from one of Morello's later bands, Audioslave, we hear the imitation of police helicopters, which open the song. Again, this is achieved by Morello by using a pencil to tap the strings along with a delay while manipulating the aforementioned whammy pedal to change the pitch, so we get those fluctuations that sound like helicopter blades cutting through air. Let's have a quick listen. Okay, so in conclusion, while mimesis is commonly used by guitarists for the purpose of demonstrating their virtuosity or for eliciting comedic responses by referencing pop culture sounds or themes, it's rarely used to imbue deeper meaning. Morello deliberately chooses to mimic sounds which signify more deep and significant meaning to the listener. We see evidence of this throughout his work in both melodic and rhythmic forms. And the sounds he imitates provide not only a roadmap of his influences and suggested listening, but also act as signifiers of his militant politics and are designed to convey understanding of this to his listeners and audience. Thank you very much for listening. Here is my bibliography. And I look forward to any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Samuel. Can you hear us from here?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Wonderful. Yes, we can hear you loud and clear. Unfortunately, I cannot see you because I'm literally behind the panel, but we're just going to stick to the audio. Oh, I can then also have the microphone. So in the meantime, I would like to open the forum for any questions.
Yes, hello. Do you hear me?
Yep.
So great. Thank you for your wonderful presentation. I have perhaps one question regarding the origins of this, as you named it, mimesis. I was just wondering, you mentioned that the origins might be traced back to 1970s, but actually what came to my mind is 1960s, and some records by the Beatles, actually, for instance, Come Together by John Lennon. Actually, it has some certain elements of mimesis and imitation, perhaps not in guitar, but by the vocal. Actually, the second, it really sounds like a kind of rebellious vocal, and also that was a political song. And also, when you mention police sirens, also the Beatles, I'm the Walrus, 1967, that there is also an imitation in the keyboard. So perhaps you can give some remark on that. Thank you.
Absolutely. No, my thing about the mimesis with Morello was the specific tracing of that sound. Definitely mimesis has been used for political commentary. Another one from the 60s is when Hendrix performed the Star Spangled Banner at Woodstock and interpolated it with sounds of war and destruction as a commentary on the Vietnam War. So I've looked into some of the kind of political mimesis before, and definitely there's lots and lots of political commentary throughout the Beatles stuff. But absolutely, in a more broader context, I'd definitely be looking into that. But this was more specifically about the imitation of this particular sound that's been sampled from hip hop. But yeah, definitely mimesis has a much broader history. But yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you. Any further questions? If not, I'm going to allow myself a moderator, Timur. First off, thank you so much. I mean, especially like the sounds of the police and the helicopters, that like really hits the nail on its head. I have actually a couple of questions, and I'm going to allow myself, as long as nobody else asks, in the meantime. First is, especially like this, reading politics in, let's call it non-political origins, which mimesis actually is. Could you tell it more about it? Because like the first thing that always pops into my head when we talk about effects in their pure technical terms is that they're not political. You argue that Tom Earl, of course, makes them political, but where does this political making of it end?
I think that one of the interesting things with this is that it's this association. It's the, like I said, it's the sonic signifier for me. It's that interesting thing that what a lot of people read as just a kind of new or interesting guitar sound when the band came out in the early 90s. To those who were aware of political hip hop, it was a very, very clear alignment with an anti-establishment movement. So I think it's a kind of by association thing, and almost acts as a kind of musical shibboleth, a kind of a signifier that is only decoded by those in the know. And so for me, for example, not coming from that understanding, I was only born in 1980. When I first heard Rage Against the Machine in the early 90s, they to me sounded like a band that had a cool guitar sound. But to people who I've spoke to since, it was a very clear alignment with very, very kind of outsider thinking in terms of the United States at that time. So for me, it's an association thing with the effects. Does that make sense?
Yes, absolutely. Which actually brings me to my next question, is exactly this, the whole genre, because you of course talk about the genre that Rage Against the Machine definitely popularized, with the new or folk metal or rap metal, of course, what we have. And there are other bands that use similar or their own signature sounds, but they do not make it political. Like think about, I don't know, Limp Bizkit or Korn, or which are kind of always on the verge being political or not. And then moving forward, having bands like System of a Down that kind of develop their own sound, also having something, a lot more of political commentary in their own sound, like Darren Marakian's guitar imitating weeps of mothers and all that. Could you tell us something more about that? How do you see that?
Absolutely. I think it's a really interesting divide between, I think a lot of the kind of rap rock bands get banded in together. And I think there's a big difference between the kind of pop kind of anti-establishment of bands like Limp Bizkit and the ones that, like you say, make very, very clear statements where there are very, very strong messages going on underneath. And I think a more broad look, I was intrigued in this, and obviously the limit of the scope of it was to look at the kind of work of Morello specifically, but I'd be really interested in expanding out and looking at System of a Down and looking at some of those things, because again, similar things, sometimes very powerful messages going on underneath that are quite often missed. And I think that's the interesting thing, is that Tom Morello spoke recently in an interview where someone tweeted at him and said, "Stay out of politics. Why are you getting involved in politics?" And he just said it terrified him that someone had been listening to his music for 30 years and thought he'd only got into politics in the last couple of years. And I think that's what's really interesting about these things, is how many people view it on a surface level and don't dig beneath and think, actually, what's being said here? Very interesting. So yeah, I'd be very interested to look into that further. Thank you for your questions.
Thank you. Any further questions? No, then I would also like to conclude with exactly what you're talking about, tweets that Tom Morello found out that Rand Paul, one of like the most conservative politicians in the US, stated him as like, he said that Rage Against the Machine, like one of his favorite bands, and Tom Morello was saying, yeah, you are the machine that we are raging against. And that's exactly this irony of things. But yeah, thank you so much, Samuel. Excellent presentation. You're gonna stick around, I hope, and we'll see you also in the virtual world. We're gonna thank you again. Clap, clap, clap. We're gonna continue this time not with a pre-recorded presentation, but with a live virtual presentation by Mark Brooks. On ethical volumes of silence and noise in TV series The Flash. Mark, can you hear us?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you loud and clear. You can start your share screen if you want to. Oh, now we can also see you. Wonderful.
You can see me. Great. Okay. All right. I don't know how well the video examples will work. We'll see how that works in a minute. Thank you very much for inviting me. I really wish I could have been there, but unfortunately I just too busy at the moment. I just couldn't come. But hopefully there'll be another opportunity to come to Sarajevo in the future. Okay, so my talk is called Why Do So Many Villains Use Sound as a Weapon? Ethical Volumes of Silence and Noise in the Flash. So, when he's still reeling after a sonic attack from Earth to metahuman Black Siren, Caitlin asks a deafened Barry Allen, also known as the Flash, why do so many villains we go up against use sound as a weapon? Well, actually, very few of the villains in The Flash or other superhero shows use specifically sonic weaponry. But all cause sonic disruption. They're all noisy in some way. Not just the sound of their weapons, but also the often dissonant or dirty music that accompanies them. In this talk, I aim to sketch out how these disruptive sonic intensities function within the larger soundscape of this particular show. Why have I decided to talk about The Flash? I've chosen to look at the soundscape of The Flash because it's probably the most affirmative and conservative superhero show on the air, containing little that would be out of place in the 1930s Superman comic. And I've been able to use the hypothesis that I develop here about how noise and silence function in mainstream superhero television to show how blues and soul and funk, and particularly hip hop, have been used more radically in the grittier, darker, more complex TV series, Luke Cage. So this is a kind of preliminary thing in order to do something, in order to talk about a more interesting, more politically activist kind of show that's in, it actually quite works in some kind of similar ways with this hip hop thing as to the talk, as in Rage Against the Machine that we just had. So let's talk about speed. So I'm labeling The Flash as politically conservative, but that isn't to say there aren't resonances with the present that might explain its popularity. And it's run to nine seasons, actually, especially among its teenage and young adult audience. So the original incarnation of The Flash from 1940 tapped into the perceived increase in the pace of modern life in cities. If you wanted to get ahead, you needed to move ever faster. But now, through the internet, this perceptual collapsing of space has been taken to its limit. We now have instant access to anywhere in the world, to anywhere in the city, or in the world. And the perception of the world as an interconnected network depends more than anything on ultra-fast fiber optic connection. And we're obsessed now with transfer speeds, download speeds, and processor speeds. To match this, the current version of the Flash can move so fast that he's virtually able to inhabit two distinct locations at once. The show functions, therefore, as an effective metaphor for a globalized networked world. New Central City stands in for the world, and Barry Allen turns it into an instantaneously connectable grid. When we see the city from above, with a Flash negotiating the city streets, rocketing up and down buildings, it's not too far removed from how we might imagine electrical or electromagnetic signals to be traveling on the internet. So if the series is up to date in this fashion, in what way is it conservative? Superhero expert Julian Chambliss explains the emergence of superhero comics as follows. Superhero comics are, to me, a consequence of the anxiety and desire associated with urbanization in the United States. Comics try to bring rationality to an urban environment that people know is intrinsically not rational. Bad things happen, you can't depend on your neighbor, you might be killed randomly, and you aren't safe. Comics take those fears and they create a narrative that mitigates or mediates those fears. People want there to be someone like Superman, who is their neighbor and who will always look out for them. To adapt Chambliss's basic point, the Flash generates a fantasy of the city as an extension of home or community in which one feels safe, comfortable, and free. Before moving on to noise, I'd first like to consider how music and sound are used to help generate the city as a unified, rational, gridded living space that can be policed by the Flash's speed and the ability to be anywhere at once. In the show, the city is frequently visualized as a grid. There are multiple shots of the city from above, often map-like views, especially on the monitors in the Star Labs where the Flash and his team are based. We see the ordered, rational nature of the city, but we also see that the Flash can whiz around it with lightning speed. The musical structure, particularly when combined with the carefully curated sound effects, creates a corresponding sonic grid. Instead of being spatial, like the images, however, it's temporal, stretching across the whole episode. The sonic grid comprises a number of identifiable musical structures. So first of all, we have sounds of speed. Sound design. There's the sound design. Barry's sound effects are made of elements of thunder, electricity, jets, fireballs, and various custom whooshes and impacts. this conveys his ability to connect any two points in the city in a flash. Then we have the Flash leitmotif. Blake Neely, the composer, uses every trick in the book to create a feeling of speed. So, for example, there's a fast tempo. We have these arpeggios whizzing up and down a wide pitch space. And we have a fast drumming figure. Also, the Flash leitmotif is also used in moments of low tension with Barry. But anytime it's heard, accompanying slow movement or an emotion such as sadness, it still had this kind of latent, pressing, urgent quality. Mainly because these kind of musical markers for speed are always present. So we hear repeated notes or syncopations, triplets. We hear these weak beat bass notes and so on. Also, Barry moves through every part of the city, suburban home, the workplace, the Star Labs, the streets, the leisure space, multiple locations. So he's covering the entire city. And this musical unity draws the city together. Another musical structure is the careful teleological organization of the music through an episode, matching and partly responsible for creating the drama. So we get this kind of fast, slow, fast, slow, fast, slow in waves, except that there is a progression from the first encounter, which is routine, to a climax near the end of the program, so that the whole program has this wave-like rational shape throughout. And finally, music without any speed component is only ever heard once throughout the entire episode, and that's briefly after the climax. So note that the story of the next episode begins before the end of each episode, so that the viewer is never left at the end of the show with a feeling of relaxation. Urgency and tension always returns with a cliffhanger. So I shall attempt, I don't know how I'm going to do this, how this is going to work. If I share my screen, perhaps I can share some of this. I'll play you a little bit of the flashlight motif, and then I'll play you a little bit of this, if it works, play you a bit of the slow version. Let me try and do that. So,
Mark, can you hear
yeah.
us? While you
yeah.
do that, we have like a slight delay, like two second delay, just so you know. So go ahead and play the video, and I hope we're also going to see it.
Let's see if we can hear something, yeah.
yeah.
Let's hear the flash light motif to start with. This is actually right at the end. This is the title sequence. Let's see if we get anything here. Let me try and play this and see if anything happens.
We do not hear anything, unfortunately.
Didn't hear anything?
Nope.
Okay. Okay. We'll maybe forget about the music examples for now then. And I did send a link to a Dropbox account in case there are any problems. Maybe we can find that in time. I don't know. Anyway, let me just carry on with the talk in the meantime. I need to stop sharing my screen somehow. Okay. So once sound designer Mark Camporel and composer Blake Neely have generated this ordered sonic grid, how does the acoustic quality of the villains and their weaponry operate within it? Here I turn to a recent book by Brandon LaBelle, in which he divides the city up into a number of acoustic territories. LaBelle associates each territory with a particular acoustic figure. So the underground is the echo and resistance, actually. The sidewalk is associated with rhythm or bodies. The street with vibration, the shopping mall with feedback, and sky with transduction. All of these acoustic territories can be found in Central City, but the most pertinent city territory here is home, for which the dual acoustic figures of silence and noise come to the fore. My main point is that supervillains are almost always figured as sonic intrusions into the peace and quiet of the well-ordered city. In the fantasy of the city as home, this is equivalent to having an inconsiderate, noisy neighbour who disrupts the free use of one's time in peace and quiet. Spent in peace and quiet. Unlike the Flash's overtly harmonious and ordered music, the music for villains is characterised by dissonance and noise. On top of this, the sound effects for their weapons assault the ear as a kind of noise pollution, muddying the silence and sonic purity of the domestic utopia. So in audio-visual terms, I want to talk about one particular episode, Pied Piper, which is a musical reference. This is series one, episode 11. In audio-visual terms, all supervillains have a sonic component to their weaponry, which usually contains some form of disruption. Pied Piper, also known as Hartley Rathaway, who became who before the explosion was Wells. Wells is the chief. Have we lost the internet connection there? He was the a protege of the labs. He was a brilliant scientist who became jealous when one of his colleagues was taken on. And we find out in flashback during the show that Hartley warned the boss, Wells, the main villain, who turns out to be the main villain of the piece, that the accelerator might explode with terrible consequences. But Wells went ahead anyway. Hartley himself was also given superhero powers by the explosion, gaining super hearing. This turned out to be more of a curse than a blessing. And at one point he says, "Every day I have to live with the agonizing, piercing screaming in my ears." And he lives in a state of permanent acoustic trauma. He takes his revenge by wreaking his own acoustic destruction. He builds himself some sonic gloves that can detect and match the resonant frequency of whatever it is he wishes to destroy. What is important here is that Hartley's attacks are specifically aimed at home and family. So, after a mildly thrilling opener, a routine operation in which the Flash apprehends three non-superhuman motorcyclists, two contrasting domestic scenes are shown. The first is Barry's home. He's at home, he's shown enjoying typically home life with his adoptive father and sister. So we witness domestic relaxation and family interaction among comfortable furniture and lighting, the suburban family ideal. Sonically, the space is characterized by silence. So there's no music, no discernible background noise. We just hear the sounds of the family. The moment is unique in the episode, which is otherwise sonically dense and the non-diegetic music almost continuous. We are then transported to Wells's house, where the first attack takes place. Suburban homes are generally depicted as an escape from rationality, means and logic of consumerism and the grid system of the city. However, Wells has a bleakly modernist home in which concrete and glass aesthetic confirms that even in his private life, is still characterized by cold, hard logic. Nevertheless, even this space can be humanized by music. The show frequently uses diegetic popular music to create leisure and personal spaces. Significantly, Wells pours himself a whiskey and puts on a CD of Nessun Dorma from Puccini's Turandot. Apart from the degenerate European classical music being a US signifier for evil, the none shall sleep idea clearly presages the noise that's just about to stop Wells getting a good night's rest, because his freely chosen sonic space is then suddenly breached. Music slows to a halt in a manner that wouldn't actually happen with a CD. Then Hartley's voice violates Wells's private space. Calling himself the Pied Piper, he warns Wells that he knows his secret. Then Wells's privately curated sonic idyll is literally shattered as Hartley uses his sonic gloves to smash all the glass in Wells's roof. So I would have an example of that. We would watch that now, but I'll have to move on. Hartley's second target is family related, concerning his family business. He was due to inherit his father and his grandfather's firm, but is sidelined when he comes out as gay. Here he uses tuned sonic blasts to destroy parts of the building. He also uses collateral damage. He also causes collateral damage, including to several police cars. And here, the sound design is again dirty and noisy. So Hartley turns out to be very easy to capture. That's because he wanted to be caught. His aim was to get into Star Labs to steal some information about Barry so that he could defeat him later. When he uses his sonic implants to escape and reclaim his gloves, we get a good example of the noise and dissonance typical of villainous music and sound effects in the series. This would be another example. at the final showdown with the Flash, Hartley is again causing disruption. It's not domestic or family disruption this time. Instead, he's interfering with a smooth operation of the city's infrastructure. Again, though, there is a domestic angle. It takes place at night, and the shots of the drivers make it clear that they're on their way home to the family. The dissonant brass chords and thundering percussion for Hartley contrast with the clean, rational, logical, harmonious music for Team Flash. The culmination of the ever more intense cacophony throughout the episode is saved for Flash's resonant frequency, which includes physically painful frequencies, as well as a vibrational component designed to render the physical effect on the of the sound on Barry's body. In the showdown, they use fire to fight fire. The reason Hartley had broken into Starlabs was to discover Barry's resonant frequency. He sets his gloves to this and attempts to shatter the Flash like a wine glass. Team Flash hit on the idea of doing the same thing. They pump a signal into the satellite radios of the cars on the bridge that vibrates the resonant frequency of the gloves, which then explode as Hartley is holding them. And this leads to this kind of this climax of this this kind of dissonance and horrible sounds that we've been hearing throughout the episode. So the conclusion. So villains are motivated by lust for power or revenge. Team Flash are motivated by the need for control and order that makes a certain amount of domestic freedom possible. Control is exerted through speed, which renders the city policeable. The city is presented visually as a grid, and this grid and its controllability is also partly generated by a sonic matrix of speed, which overlays each episode. The show promotes an acoustic morality in which noise is associated with disruption and breakdown or invasion, and silence with home, family, and freedom. The acoustic morality is the ideal of the suburbs, and the show, therefore, supports the fantasy of the city as a giant suburb, or even a giant home, a community in which difference is moderated and sameness considered a virtue. Aimed at millennials, the show shares certain socially progressive assumptions about racial, race, gender, and sexuality. But recall, noise is a sound out of place. So familiar sounds, sounds of conformity and sameness, are accepted and tolerated as conceptually belonging to the category of silence. The acoustic morality of silence good, noise bad, means that the show covertly endorses the suburban ideal of sameness and conformity, positioning itself against a more vibrant urban space generated by an openness to difference and even confrontation. Okay, thank you very much. Sorry about the sound examples.
Thank you so much. This is usually the moment where we'll be having a discussion, but since we're having a tiny bit of an issue with the, we are not going in Flash. Would you mind that I collect the questions like after this session and mail them to you?
And yeah, sure. And yeah, I can send.
Yeah, and if you could, we would really appreciate that you send us the examples, and we can then discuss them afterwards. Is that fine by you? Because I myself have like two or three questions. Somebody who really likes the Flash and Arrow and everything, but just like towards the other referees that we shortened up here. We are really enjoyed, at least I did, your presentation. I'm really looking forward also to hearing exactly, because of course, like we all know, like talking about stuff and then seeing it is completely different. Yeah. I will nonetheless open the forum if there's somebody who like really wants to ask a question. This is your moment. If not, then please just forward me your questions, and I'm gonna write to Mark afterwards. If no, I'm not seeing any immediate questions, then I'm gonna say thank you once again, Mark.
Thank you.
And we're gonna head to the last paper presentation of today by Marcel Bouvry, Go Together, State Subsidizing Popular Music of the Stad in the Netherlands. This is also a live presentation, and we are looking forward to your presentation. Marcel, stage is yours.
Hello, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Ah, perfect. I have a PowerPoint presentation. I can share my screen. Is that?
That should.
Can you see the PowerPoint presentation?
That should be possible when you share your screen. And in case you have some audio files, just check the share audio, share computer audio.
Yeah, I'll skip the audio for time's sake.
Oh, thank you.
All right.
We still
see
you.
Let me
see
if this works.
Wonderful.
Can you see my PowerPoint now?
Yes, we can.
Ah, perfect. All right, then I'll start. So I hope you have a lovely conference. Sorry I couldn't be there. Maybe I'll be there in the future, next conferences. So in 2016, Dutch rock band De Staat, which translates as The State, named after Louis Andriessen's composition, De Staat, from 1976, which in turn is named after Plato's Republic, received a state funding of almost 1 million euros spread across 4 years from the Dutch government. This caused quite some controversy, as it is unusual, though not the first time, that a popular music artist was granted such a large amount of money as state subsidy, as it is usually reserved for serious and high art. It received a lot of media attention and spawned a debate whether popular music should be funded by the government, as the general public and some of the written press in the Netherlands raised questions about pop's relationship with commerce, which should make it not eligible for state subsidy. My paper today will focus on two sides of this event. First, I will explain some of the workings of the funding of music in Dutch society. And second, I will examine the reception on social media and in the written press on the subsidy of the Staat. And I will relate it to key factors that play a role in the historical development of the relationship between pop music and Dutch state funding. Both these threads provide interesting insights in the dynamics of music within the society of the Netherlands. So first, a few words about the band themselves. De Staat is an innovative rock band with influences from electronic music, dance, hip hop, music theater, and incorporate experimental video art in their music videos. They base their name on Dutch composer Louis Andriessen's composition, De Staat, which is in turn inspired by the Dutch translation of Plato's Republic. And this reference to Andriessen echoes a period of radical change in the dynamics between music and society in the 60s. Andriessen was an essential figure in a movement of the so-called Notenkrakers, which translates as the Nutcrackers, in which several like-minded composers heavily criticized the dominance of a conservative, predominantly late romantic repertoire that went at the expense of a more avant-garde and experimental idiom in Dutch musical culture. The band De Staat also conveys social political critique in many of their songs in a liberal, left-leaning fashion and push the envelope in combining multimedia and technology in their performances and music videos. The multiple year fund, consisting of 944,800 euro, the most to any pop band in Dutch history, was granted to them by the Performing Arts Fund and was meant to function as a springboard for the band to develop into a front runner in Dutch popular music culture and to pursue a more international career. So a few words on the Performing Arts Fund. The Performing Arts Fund NL, Fonds Podiumkunst in Dutch, is the national fund for music, music theater, dance, and theater and music festivals in the Netherlands, and provides on behalf of the Dutch government a support to the national musical infrastructure and aids performers in their artistic careers. It offers several different funds and programs that help Netherlands-based artists and organizations in the national and international ambitions. Besides individual and project grants, the fund offers multi-year activity grants, in which an organization is granted a fund for 4 years, focusing on longevity and structural financial aid. And this is what I'm talking about today. This is seen as the most prestigious fund, for it has the biggest budget and is divided over four disciplines: music, theater, dance, and a fifth one, also kind of related, is for culture festivals. For the periods I focus on, for 2017 to 2020, the total budget was €26,850,000 each year, for a period over 4 years, of which €6 million was reserved for music, which is approximately 22%. Of all the 212 requests, 84 were granted. In the category of music, this was 45 requests with 18 granted. And the total amount of requested funding was €54,912,000, of which the 26,850,000 was granted, just slightly under 50%. In terms of music, the requested amount was 12,493,000, of which 6,351,000 was granted, which is roughly 50%. The staat requested, and again, these are amounts per year for a 4 year period, 282,500, and were granted 236,000, which is just about 3.7% of the total granted fund in the music category. So in this light, pop music only plays a marginal role in the multiple year subsidy, which focuses mostly on classical and improvisation-based music. The fund works with a committee of advisors whose judgment is based on the balance between artistic qualities and the feasibility of the submitted plans. There are different committees for each discipline, and its members are selected by the board based on their expertise of the discipline and on their autonomous and independent relation to the parties that applied for a funding. Each advisor judges the request through a framework of criteria, which I will discuss later, and these individual assessments are compared and tested for consistency and deviation under the supervision of an external chairman or chairwoman. Any inconsistency was to be addressed and evaluated into the final judgment. Now, important to state that this is the process as described in their own report, so it's very difficult to tell whether or not this corresponds to the actual workings, if you have to assume their words. For the multiple year grant, the framework on which the committee based their judgment consists of four criteria. First, artistic quality, which is based on past achievements and accolades of the requester and the expected quality of future performances. Second one is entrepreneurship, which focuses on the awareness of the requester on the business side of cultural life and on the economic feasibility and viability of their plans. The third one, pluriformity, in which the diversity of the institution and its ability to engage with a pluriform audience is judged. This can be cultural, ethnic, or gender diversity. They're usually valued in this category. The fourth category is geographical dispersion, which assesses the ability of the institution to connect to audiences and other cultural institutions throughout the country. Now, of course, we can put several question marks on these criteria and how relevant these are to judge cultural production, but that transcends the scope of this paper today. If we look at the request of the staat, a 38-page document written by the band's management, we see that they carefully address each criterion and carefully state the relation between their innovative artistic ambitions and their proposed budgets that should effectuate their plans. In their request, they carefully emphasize the misconception that musicians working within popular music world are earning enough to make a decent living, and that those working in a more alternative scene, where the focus is on artistic merit over profit, thus need financial support. They position themselves as an alternative band with an emphasis on creativity, authenticity, interdisciplinary, and innovation, working on the fringes of mainstream musical culture in the Netherlands. This image the band creates in their request is neatly shaped to address the criteria of the Performing Arts Fund and allows a clear opportunity for the fund to assess them on these. In terms of artistic quality, the fund praised the authenticity and their innovative conceptualization of performing, the incorporation of video art in their live shows and their music videos, and the tour of the band's frontman in collaboration with another Dutch artist in elderly homes across the country. In terms of entrepreneurship, the fund praised the balanced and carefully considered budgeting plan of combining income streams from performing, royalties from publishing rights, sponsorship, and the money they would receive from the fund. But this makes it clear that the fund only grants subsidy for organizations with a healthy economic foundation and clear budgeting plans. The SAAT did not score that high on the pluriformity criterion and was assessed as neutral because of the one-dimensional aspect of rock music. The fund did, however, praise the interdisciplinary collaboration with video and lighting designs, although they hold this as a standard element in contemporary pop music. In a final criteria, geographical dispersion, the band scored extremely well because of their flexibility in touring the entire country. Now let's take a look at the reception and critique of the granted subsidy. The granted subsidy of about 1 million euro for the Staat caused a wide array of reactions and debates within the written press and on social media. While some of this more serious written press applauded the bold decision of the fund to stimulate innovative and experimental pop music, the general scope of the messages on social media were skeptic and disdainful. Many condemned the sheer amount of the subsidy for a popular band consisting of just 5 members, while others criticized the fact that popular music is eligible for funding at all. These criticisms show a general view that pop music, with its emphasis on commerce, should be able to finance itself, and state funding should support music that focuses more on artistic merit. These messages show the persistence of the false binary between artistic merit and commercial viability on social media. It also demonstrates an unawareness of the general public of the relationship between state subsidy and pop music, which is already operating underneath the surface for 5 decades in the Netherlands. In his study on popular music and government policy in the Netherlands between 1975 and 2001, André Nugelmans reflects on 4 important contrasts that seem to play a role in the struggle regarding the history of pop music and state funding. The complex distinction between amateurism and professionalism, and this border is less clear than in classical music, for example, although in the last 2 decades with several popular music departments at prestigious conservatories, we see a sense of professionalization of popular music in the country. Second, the close relationship between pop music and commerce, in which the erroneous view that most popular musicians are self-sufficient is pervasive and a blind spot of the more alternative popular music scene. Third, the dynamics between chaos and order, in which the rebellious side of popular music was at odds with the morals of hard working and thriftiness of the pre-war generation. And since the 70s, there has been a gradual shift from the view of popular music as an undermining factor for society to one of genuine cultural or subcultural and youthful liberatory expression. And finally, the contrast between new and old art, where the view persists that subsidy to new innovative art forms should not be at the cost of older art forms. It was not until the 1990s that there was a structural cooperation between pop and classical music organizations to advocate a more eclectic landscape to serve a more cultural omnivorous audience. So on the one hand, the subsidy of the Staat demonstrates a continuation of these complex contrasts regarding state funding popular music, as the public opinion clearly still holds a skeptic and conservative view on this. But on the other hand, it marks a pivotal moment for pop music, as the exceptional amount of the fund demonstrates a view of pop music that is worthy of structural state subsidy. In 2019, the Council for Culture, which is a body established by law to advise the Dutch government and parliament on the arts, culture, and media, strongly advised a more structural funding for the more popular arts, such as pop music, fashion, design, e-culture, urban arts, and musicals. The Minister of Culture accepted this advice, and the plans for a more structural support for popular arts were on their way when COVID-19 threw a spanner in the works and demanded an entirely different funding structure in order to support those who suffered most from the pandemic. But this is the topic for a future paper. I thank you for your attention, and I'll show my bibliography and gladly answer your questions if we still have the time to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Will. Marcel? I would like to open the forum for one or two questions. I will then allow myself one question. You exactly hinted it towards the end. How does the financing of the Staat then translate to the general public financing of different bands and cultural establishments during COVID-19, starting in 2020?
The state support for bands and cultural life in general was met pretty positively in the COVID crisis, because everything was closed and people really just were confronted with the fact that nobody could participate in cultural life. So there were pretty positive support there.
So the outrage that we could see, like after this huge grant to the Staat, then was not visible with the other bands.
Not really, no.
Okay, that's.
It was in the beginning, like when I just received the grant in 2016. There were a lot of other artists who were kind of it was quite an outrage for some bands there.
Okay, thank you. We have one more question from Olivia Ramos.
Hi, Marcel. So my question is actually, I was kind of surprised when I saw that you said that there were 212 total requests for the Performing Arts Fund. You don't work at the Performing Arts Fund, but I'm just thinking, how come only 212 requests, of which 84 were granted? And one of those would be, let's say, a band. So is this is the main public fund for the performing arts? What does it include? Because, you know, just when you say theater, festivals, music, dance, everything. So I was kind of surprised, because we are from Bosnia, much smaller country, with much smaller budgets. I would say that this is less than we have on a canton level.
Yeah. Well, these were the requesters for the multiple year fund, which is the 4 year fund for a 4 year period. There are other funds which get a lot of requests as well, but a lot of especially bands, they don't even really think about requesting for the multiple year fund because they think they are not eligible at all for this. They think it's reserved for classical music and jazz. So on the one hand, the Staat, with this very bold move of trying to request a fund, was actually very surprising and inspired a lot of other bands to request for this multiple year fund as well. So we see an increase at last multiple year request. So we see an increase in popular music bands requesting the fund.
If there are no further questions, I would like to say once again, thank you so much, Marcel.
And yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you to all other presenters, to Samuel, to Mark, and once again to Marcel. I would like to close this session, and I think we're not going to make it. We're going to make a short 5 minute break because we are a tiny bit late with everything. Thank you all for coming, and see you at this very venue in 5 minutes.